Hey friend, I'm your host Leenie Heiss, and this is episode 103 of the Moms in Prayer podcast. What a week. All we can say is the name of Jesus over the crisis happening in the world today. I have never been more grateful than I am right now that somebody came alongside me and taught me to pray. It's not enough to watch the news and know you should pray. Moms in Prayer has taught us how to intercede in prayer. Last night, I was talking with Moms in Prayer President Sally Burke and our global director, Kathy Armitage, about the rioting we see across America and in parts of the world. Today, Sally is issuing a call to Moms in Prayer women everywhere to pray for peace and reconciliation in our nation. We're asking for you to intercede for the safety and well-being of children everywhere of every skin color. We are praying that they would walk into their call to follow Jesus and become everything God has called them to be. Please join us at this critical moment in history. In the middle of a global pandemic and racial riots, our only hope is Jesus, the reconciler and healer of us all. Each week, we try to bring you content that encourages, empowers, and equips you to reach the next generation for Christ and to spur you on to pray powerfully and effectively for the kids in your life. That includes our kids who are trying to process their emotions about being separated from their friends and experiencing the disappointments of missing major milestones. We are especially mindful of the disappointments the graduating class of 2020 is experiencing. Today's guest is my friend, author, and speaker, Jennifer Dukes Lee, and her daughter, Lydia, and you are going to love them. Get ready for a great interview as you hear from Lydia, a very articulate class of 2020 grad. You are going to love her. Before we get started, Moms in Prayer is a nonprofit ministry, and we are funded by the financial gifts of our listeners and prayer warriors like you. Would you please take a minute and make a donation to this life-changing ministry at our website at momsinprayer.org, or you can text the word steward to the number 41444. That's the word steward to 41444. You can find all of the things we talk about and ways to connect with our guests in our show notes on our blog at momsinprayer.org. Now, let's get started. Well, Jennifer Dukes Lee, welcome to the Moms in Prayer podcast.
So fun to be here, Lee. Thank you.
I'm so glad to have you, friend. Would you introduce yourself to our audience?
Sure. My name is Jennifer, and I live on a farm in Northwest Iowa. And my husband and I here, we're growing crops, pigs, and two beautiful humans. And the humans have names, Lydia and Anna. They're both teen girls. And so I am definitely a mom in prayer. And I am also a book author. My third book and Bible study came out in September of 2018 called It's All Under Control. And I just finished my manuscript for my next book that will come out next year. So I'm also a book editor for a publishing house in Michigan, actually.
I love that. Right up the road from me. So fun. Well, today we are joined by one of your beautiful humans, your daughter, Lydia. Lydia, hello. Welcome to the Moms in Prayer podcast.
Hi, thank you so much for having me here.
It's so good to see you. And Jennifer, I know Lydia is not going to want to brag on herself, but would you tell us a little bit about this wonderful human sitting next to you?
Oh, this is a mom's dream, like permission to boast. Talk about how proud she is of her child. So Lydia is a graduating senior at West Lyon High School, and she is a 4.0. I'm just going to say,
okay.
Honey,
okay.
you've done so well, and you've worked so hard, and she is extremely active in music, having made All-State in clarinet 4 years in a row. She's accomplished in piano, both classically and jazz. She's been involved in FFA, which is formerly Future Farmers of America, but I don't think you go by that anymore.
No, we don't.
But, you know, really kind of an ag-based club of leadership. It just a captain of the football cheerleading squad, just active in speech, and it just goes on and on. She just does all of the artistic things, and yeah, that is like a total breakfast. And thank you very much for letting me do that.
I love that. I love that so much. It's been fun on Facebook over the years to watch Lydia grow up. And what an honor to get to meet you in person, Lydia. I wonder, you're in the graduating class of 2020. That means you're the COVID class.
Yes.
Right?
Yes, we are. Uh-huh.
I'm sure there's like a lot wrapped up in that. And Lydia, tell us about the day that you received word that you wouldn't be going back to school.
Yeah, well, I walked out of my school building on a normal Friday in the middle of March, and I had no clue that I just had my last day of school. I mean, it was just a normal day. And right after that weekend, school got canceled for 4 weeks, and that turned into the rest of the year. And it was so hard for me because I was like, how would I have thought about that day differently if I'd known that that was my very last day as a student after 13 years at this school? And then all these milestone moments that I had waited for, they all just got knocked off one by one. My last band concert, my last FFA banquet, graduation, prom. And it's just been really, really difficult.
Yeah, it's a huge loss, friend. And we didn't know. We didn't know that that was the last day. And I'm sure that was very emotional. Tell me how you felt in the middle of that, because I'm going to go ahead and assume that most graduating seniors had a lot of feelings too.
Yeah. Well, it was very confusing. It was so hard to wrap my mind around that in such a short span of time. The world that I had known and the life that I'd always planned for, and this ending to my senior year that I'd imagined, it was just gone and it wasn't going to happen. And that just, it shocked me. And it was really hard for me to adapt to that for a few days. I sat around a lot and I cried a lot. It was so hard for me to adjust. And I think speaking with a lot of my peers, I think we've all gone through that in one way or another.
Mm-hmm. Grief, sadness, just a lot of feelings. But I know that a prayer kind of shifted something inside of you. Tell me about that.
Yeah. So I was just laying in bed one night, probably a week or so after I had gotten out of school. And I was just like, God, I can't do this anymore. I can't live like this. I can't stay so caught up in my grief that it's keeping me from living the life that I know you want me to live. So just fill me with your peace and fill me with acceptance of these circumstances that I'm in. And just immediately, just like a wave of peace came over my body. And I was like, you know what? I can do this. It's going to be hard, but I think that God can use me even in hard times. And I can still make the most of whatever circumstances I find myself in.
What a gift that was. Jennifer, I know that you've been praying for Lydia and her friends too. What have you been praying specifically?
Yes. So I think that first, big picture, I've been praying for them the same thing that I think I've been praying for all of us, because all of our lives were turned upside down. All of our plans were sort of wrecked or rearranged. And so a mantra for myself and for our family, and really that I pray for everyone I know, is to have strength for today and hope for tomorrow, based on a line in an old hymn, because it's shown us that it really is true. You know, I think in America, we get so self-sufficient and we rely a lot on our plans and our long-range plans and how we have our lives laid out before us. We don't think a lot about the strength that I need to get through this day and the hope that tomorrow will be better. And so I pray that generally for these kids. My prayer for them specifically as seniors and as students was that they would stay focused on their studies. Here, school was sort of optional, but that they would continue to work hard at their studies, because they will need to have that as a foundation for their future in college or for their future years in high school. That they would find bright spots every day, that there would be peace in the homes. I thought, and Lydia and I talked a lot about people who were in homes that weren't healthy, that were difficult homes. And so we spent a lot of time praying for those children who were in really difficult situations and suddenly had to be under a roof with a parent or a sibling or somebody else that maybe was sort of dangerous to be around. And just praying that people would hold on to Jesus in this, and that it would be an opportunity for students to grow in their faith. And I saw that lived out in our home. Lydia has always been, since she's grown into young adulthood, she's always been very good about every morning sitting at the table and reading her Bible and filling out her prayer journal. And I have watched her do that consistently, sometimes better than I have. I've watched her faith grow through this. And Anna's too, our younger daughter, I've watched her faith grow. I've watched, as we're watching our church services on the screen, on Facebook Live, taking notes and holding on to what God has to say about how to deal with hard times. And so my prayer has been that my children would that would be something that they would take with them out of this.
So well said. And so similar to the prayers that many of us are praying is just, Lord, help us to have hope that this is going to not only get better, but that we're going to walk away from this stronger. So Lydia, so funny. Saw on Facebook this letter that you had written to the class of 2020. And my first thought was, oh, she's not just like her mama, but articulate. And that letter got picked up by Fox News. And even I bet some of our listeners watched your interview. Lydia, you issued a challenge to the class of 2020. And I'll link that letter in the show notes so that people can go ahead and read it because it's well written. But tell me about the challenges that you issued to your peers.
Yeah. Oh, so I had three challenges that I wanted to give to my peers. The first one was to enjoy this time with family. So like in my house, I'm basically trapped in a house with my wonderful parents and my sister. So I just wanted to challenge seniors to really make the most of this time because soon most of us are off to college and are the workforce, and we're not going to get to see our family members that we love so much every day. So I wanted to challenge them to join in on family movie night, stay up till midnight talking with your sister, just really treasure this time with family because we're not going to get to have a lot of it soon. Yeah. And then my second challenge was to just use this time to grow yourself. So like me, as my mom mentioned, I'm very involved at school, always busy, always go, go, go. I feel like I never have time to do the things I want to do. I wish I had time to read more. I wish I had time to do this or learn this. And now suddenly life has stopped and we have so much time on our hands. And I wanted to challenge my fellow seniors not to waste that time, but to use it to grow themselves. So put effort into schoolwork, whether you're required to complete it or not. Learn a new language, learn a new instrument, gain a new skill, read that book you've always wanted to read. Like you mentioned, come out of this pandemic a better, more improved person. And then my final challenge was to view this pandemic as a learning opportunity. So I'm sure, I mean, not just seniors, but people around the world, we kind of like to make our plans. And we like to go on with our daily lives without a care in the world until we're totally stopped in our tracks. And that just rang true for me as a senior because I always assumed, oh, I'd get to have prom. I'd get to have my last day of school. And that didn't really happen. So what can be gained and learned is that nothing in life is ever promised. No tomorrow is guaranteed. So we need to make the most of every moment that we're given.
Oh, friend, that's so wise. Not only do I want to line up my children right now, but I'm like Lydia Lee for president. I don't know. I mean, I'm in. I just think that as you've taken time to reflect on this, that what God has brought to you is wisdom. And that is our answer to our prayer, Jen, isn't it? It's just like to watch our kids growing in the grace and knowledge of Jesus. To walk in humility and wisdom is really, really a powerful thing. And I think it's hilarious that you wrote a book about letting go of control because while the context may be a little different, letting go of control is absolutely what this season is about, isn't it?
That's for sure. You know, when I wrote that book, I didn't know that some of its highest sales would happen in the midst of a global pandemic. It keeps getting sold out on Amazon because people are like, my life is out of control. What am I supposed to do? And I think that especially the Bible study is really selling strongly because I think that we do tend, I think this is really an Americanized problem, tend to long range plan, have our 401ks, make sure that we've got it all figured out, our retirement savings, like everything we do, you know, the kids are supposed to know kind of freshman year, what they're going to build toward as a major, like everything in our lives is so planned out. And we were all, you know, the brakes were tapped and we were all slowed down to this point of having to trust God in ways that we talk about a lot, but don't always live. Mm. And in some ways, living the lessons of it's all under control and finding the peace of letting go of things that I needed to let go of, in some ways that prepared me for what we're experiencing now. But in other ways and important ways, you can't prepare for something like this that you never knew would happen. And so lessons have been learned along the way. And I'd say, I often turn to the girls and I'll say, I've never parented in a pandemic before. So yeah. You bear with me as I try to figure this out and figure out where to loosen the strings on you guys. And you know, where I'm supposed to be, you know, the mom who says, no, you may not go, or no, you may not have that friend over or whatever. You know, I just feel like I'm having to lean on God for decisions that I've perhaps left him out of in the past, and really just learning to live. I've always had, since I've been a child, this tendency to hold my plans tightly in my fists, so tightly, but God cannot put anything into closed fists. And so more and more through this season, he's been opening my hands and has been placing in them different kinds of gifts that I wouldn't have been able to experience otherwise. And that was the lesson of it's all under control. But again, yeah, in this context, I'm learning it in a whole new way.
What are you thinking about God right now? I say that because as a farm wife as well, farming keeps us pretty aware that we are out of control of certain things. Like, I cannot make it rain. As much as I have wanted it to rain during years of drought on our farm, I could not make it rain. Likewise, in last year, you know this too, I could not make it stop raining. No matter what I did, fields were underwater. We couldn't get things planted. It was just the reality that we live in. But as a mom, this takes on a whole nother level. What do you understand about God that allows you to trust him?
You know, one of the things that I have learned about God is simply every day walking out the front door and tipping my face to the sky. The sun keeps on rising every morning, and it keeps on setting every night. And the ground begs for seed. And the rains have come, and the sun, and the seasons keep turning. And God says in Ecclesiastes that there is a season for everything. There's a time for everything under heaven. There's even a time for these things, for these difficult things. You know, I remember reading years ago, there's a time for embracing and a time for not embracing in Ecclesiastes 3. And I thought, a time for not embracing? What's that? Like, we're not embracing right now. And it, to me, it says that God is sovereign over all of these seasons, even the difficult ones. I don't think he takes any joy in not having us hug each other, but I think he does take joy in knowing that once we embrace again, that we will appreciate it more than ever before. So for me, it's encountering God, not always just in the words of my Bible or in my prayers, but literally by putting my feet on the ground outside and tipping my face to the sky.
We talked about the emotions that Lydia faced, but there's also emotions that moms are working through right now. Because as I think of the list of things that I want to see happen in my kids' lives, I like long for the moment of high school graduation. I'm sure that I've got moms listening who are longing for college graduations and weddings that are not happening right now, or happening and they look a lot different than we expected them to. How are you navigating the disappointments that your family's experiencing as a mom?
I've had to really give myself permission to feel what I need to feel, because I feel like as a mom, we spend a lot of time managing the emotions of our children and helping them navigate it. But we're dealing with it too.
Yeah, we are.
There's some days where I've had, you know, Lydia will have a good cry and I'll just cry right along with her. And later, you know, I'll, you know, regret that I handled something the way that I did and have to apologize. I mean, I feel like my emotions are just all over the place. And so just allowing myself to feel what I need to feel, and whether that's anger or sorrow or disappointment or whatever it is, just allowing myself space to feel. And a counselor told me one time that a great way to deal with negative emotions, if you don't want to wallow in them forever, is to set a time limit. Like, I'm going to give myself till 1 o'clock today to feel this way, but then I'm going to kind of move on. Or maybe it's that I get till Friday. And then there are tougher seasons where maybe you have to allow yourself, you know, an indefinite period of time to really get through something. And I don't want to make light of that. But I think for a lot of the feelings that I have on a daily basis, if I just give them a time limit, allow myself to feel what I need to feel, and then pick up and move on, I feel that's a good balance for me.
I love that. I read recently that you wrote that we're taking these supposed to happen moments and turning them into going to moments. Tell me about that.
Yeah. So there were so many supposed to's that we kept talking about, but I was supposed to have graduation today, but I was supposed to have prom, and we grieved all those supposed to's, but we tried to figure out ways of what are we going to do instead. because we're not going to sit on the couch or in our dark bedrooms and be sad about the supposed tos, because it's just going to get us nowhere. So for instance, on the day when she was supposed to have a Jane Austen styled tea party graduation here in the home, we ended up having we're going to have fun. So we had her three closest friends in the garage, and they had a sort of progressive dinner from the garages or yards of her closest friends. And we had a progressive dinner, and at each of the homes, they had a surprise guest teacher zoom in. Maybe it was a teacher from their elementary years. Their band instructor was one of the guests, and they each had about 5 minutes of just really kind, encouraging words to say to the kids. And that's something that they would not have gotten otherwise. I mean, we were kind of ridiculous. We had like a unicorn themed party here and a pinata, and it was just sort of ridiculous, but it was so fun, and it was something that we wouldn't have had otherwise. And we just were determined that we were going to make the most of it.
You know, it's funny, when we found out that we were quarantining at home alone, the first thing I did was try to find food, number one. The second thing that I did when I realized that a lot of things were missing from the shelves was I tried to figure out what was on the shelves. And what was left on the shelves of our store was Play-Doh. And we, bless the Lord, had food to eat. But my high schoolers and middle schoolers and elementary schoolers, we played Play-Doh because we could, because when do we ever have time to do that? Now we're getting ready for college, we're not doing this, but there's a lot of things that kind of go out the window and we get to spend time doing as a family. What other fun things, Lydia, have you done during this period of time?
I've been doing a lot of reading. I think I've read probably close to 10 books. All kinds of books. I learned how to embroider, so I've embroidered some tea towels for my grandma's. What else have I done? I've practiced a lot. I'm majoring in music next year, so I usually try to spend a couple hours every day practicing clarinet and piano. But yeah, I've just been trying to keep busy doing productive things, but also fun things.
I love that. So Lydia, what are your college plans for next year?
I am attending Iowa State, and I'm majoring in music education.
So good. Jen, as we wrap up, would you be willing to pray for the class of 2020? I cannot think of anybody I'd rather pray for the class of 2020. And I just want to say to you guys before we close down our interview that I'm really, really proud of the way both of you are leading in this time. And Lydia, it may not even feel like it, but there are people who are watching, and the faith that you've put in the Lord in the middle of this time, the way that you turn to Him, that's something that, honey, is going to benefit you for the rest of your days. We are so, so proud of you. And Jennifer, thanks for speaking light into this world, friend. Would you pray for the class of 2020?
Absolutely. Lord, we come to you just grateful that we get to be educated, that we have teachers and school buildings, or if we're homeschooled, parents who care for us and teach us and lead us. And Lord, when all that gets shaken and structures get tossed out the window, you remain steady. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And Lord, let that be a lesson that we take with us into our futures, that the class of 2020 would take into their futures, that this wouldn't have made them weaker, but that this would have made them stronger and more resilient, not in their own strength, really, but in the Lord, that they would look back on this time and look at it that when so many things fell away, that the most important things remained steady, the most important things being relationships, loving one another, caring for one another, being the church when you can't be inside the church. And most of all, Lord, the one steady, true thing that is constant through all our lives is your presence with us. Lord, have the class of 2020 remember that well, how you were with us and that you grew us and stood by us, whether we were playing with Play-Doh or standing outside under a sunny sky, reading a book or having another class on Zoom. Lord, that we would just remember that you were sitting there and watching and holding and being present with us. And go with this class as they take this next step in their journey, and with all of the parents who are having to let their little birdies fly out of the nest. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Wasn't that a fun interview? When I heard Lydia share about her prayer, I knew we had to talk with her. Prayer changes students and moms. Of course it does. That's the way of Jesus. Is there a mom or a 2020 grad in your world who needs some encouragement who would benefit from listening to today's episode and Lydia's challenge? Would you take a minute to share this episode with her? If this is your first time here, thank you so much for joining us. You can learn all about the ministry God has given us to pray for children in schools around the world on our website at momsinprayer.org. We love being on this journey with you, friends. If you have stories about how God is working where you are, email us at podcast@momsinprayer.org. Moms make the difference. Moms having mermaid parties and progressive graduation dinners. Moms just like you. See you next week.